Let us pause. Let us feel the presence of the Lord in us. Let us hear the wisdom of old, the wisdom from the Psalms. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. Psalms 133, a song of ascents. Welcome to all. My name is Laurent Vernet, and I would like to invite you to this special moment, 45 minutes, being you, just you, you with God. May you be on the phone using a transcript or watching the recording or be with us live online. You are all welcome to this special time where we pause and be, just be. We are the second Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen. What a news. Repeated every year for over 2,000 years, and people still struggle to understand its full meaning. And many of us will ignore the pure, amazing truth behind Christ's resurrection, preferring to sink in a worldly reality, which has, unfortunately, very little to offer as hope. We are together, we are gathering, so let us celebrate this time together with our first hymn, which is Come With Me, Come Wander, Come Welcome the World.
Sing hey for the people who lead.
Dave, please, could you lead us in prayer?
Let us pray. Creator God, we are your children, gathering at this time and in this place, wherever you are. We are meeting in body and in spirit, and also through your gift of technology and connection. May it be the phone, transcripts or computer, or iPad or telephone. You created the universe, our planet Earth, and our humanity through dusts, gas, and a big bang. You blessed your children, us, with many gifts, including your steadfast love and your generous compassion. We are all your children, children of a loving Father, Mother, God, playing between the light and the shadows of our existence. We are dancing in your sun and finding comfort in your arms when we fall down. We are a family in you, Lord. We rejoice about the coming spring, even if the spring is not always obvious to us with the showers of snow and hail and cold mornings. We know that spring is coming. There are many signs around us, flowers, animals, our knowledge of the calendar, and trust in seasons. Lord, we are rejoicing in your resurrection. Even in your presence is not always obvious to our senses. We have faith, and we know that you are here and now with us. There are many signs around us about your presence and your coming. Open our hearts so that we may be in full communion with you. Lord, we approach you in mind, body, and soul. We dedicate this time to you. You are among us, gathered, united in you. May you bless this gathering today. This place becomes holy ground through our communion with you. May we, you and us, be one of this gathering. Amen.
Let us pray together. Almighty and loving God, we turn to you to open our hearts like flowers in spring and share with you our regret of not always act or be like the children you will expect us to be, or act and be like we would like to be. The flesh and the mind are weak, and so we confess to you our wrongdoings and weaknesses. In your love, Lord, may we be forgiven. My brothers, sisters, and friends, in the past days we have been betrayed your trust and love. We have not been the brothers and sisters and friends in God we ought to be, as we have committed to be through our baptism and membership to this church. In our wrongdoings, we ask you, sisters and brothers and friends, that you forgive us. In the name of our Lord, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. We are reconciled with the family of God. May the Lord bless us and keep us strong against temptation, complacency, and wrongdoings. Amen. And I would like to invite you now to join me in the following hymn written by Charles Wesley. Jesus, Lord, we look to thee.
Thank you. Today's reading are coming from two different books in our Holy Scriptures. One is Genesis at the beginning of the book, and one is almost at the end, is the Gospel of John. In both cases, we will see a human encounter with God and the difficulty of this encounter. In Genesis, Jacob is having a lot of doubts. He is on his own. It's the evening. He's in the middle of the desert. And we meet God. And we will hear about it. The second one is Jesus' resurrection. Or more exactly, resurrection for some, but not for everyone. Some people haven't met the resurrected Jesus yet and have doubts about it. And we're going to hear about that as well. Both cases where humans are struggling with the reality of God because it doesn't fit what they thought they will be expecting from God. Maybe a little bit of our experience there, isn't it? So let's hear the two readings. One will be read by Margaret, and the other one will be read by Jacqueline.
This reading is from Genesis chapter 32, verses 23 to 32. Jacob took his family and sent them across the stream of Jabbok, and likewise everything he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the thigh muscle that is on the hip socket, because he struck Jacob on the hip socket at the thigh muscle.
Hear the good news from our Holy Scriptures. Today we read from the Gospel according to John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After this, he said this. He showed them his hands and his sides. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the marks of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This ends our gospel reading. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Do you remember the 22nd of January 2017? Anything special on that day you will remember? Maybe not. But on that day, a speech made a great impact in the world. Not because it announced anything special, but just it confirmed in simple words a reality we have been confronting for many years, if it's not centuries. It was part of a speech of a politician, or more exactly, the US counselor to the President of the United States, someone called Kellyanne Conway. And in that speech, this counselor tried to convince the journalist that what they have experienced based on fact was not the truth, and they needed to accept an alternative fact to embrace the truth which was told to them. Alternative facts? Amazing choice of words. There's facts and facts, not alternative facts. When reality doesn't suit us, does that mean that we should build an alternative reality? So in this case, let us open the doors to the unicorns, to Star Trek, to the flat earth and magics. Could it be what happened to the disciple Thomas in our reading? Thomas believing that the disciple were telling him alternative fact. Thomas rejecting the claim from the disciple as a wishful dream, an alternative fact or a trick of the mind of mourners. Many people who mourn will experience that situation called denial, when we reject the death of the one we loved. Could it be what Thomas had in mind? In John Gospels, we heard Thomas only twice before this specific passage. And twice, Thomas, in chapter 11 and 14, shows a total commitment to Jesus, ready to follow him wherever Jesus will go. Total loyalty. It is like Thomas. It is not like Thomas to doubt in Jesus. Thomas, in this passage, doesn't doubt Jesus. In fact, when you're looking closely to the text, he doubts the other disciples, what they're telling him. Read the passage again, and you will see that it is unfair to blame Thomas. To blame Thomas, to be doubtful, or to be faithless, or to have a weak faith. I will suspect Thomas was about very upset by the irony that twice he publicly claimed that he will be there wherever Jesus is. And when Jesus appears, he's not there. What an irony. Annoying for Thomas, I suspect. Thomas doubts the disciples. It's not possible what they're saying. So he just tells them that he needs to touch Jesus' body to make it convincing. And it is not a dream on their side. It's not an alternative fact from them. He has no intention to touch it, to put his fingers in it. And in fact, again, look at the text. It is pretty obvious that he doesn't do it, even when Jesus invites him to do so. It is a kind of test to make sure that the apparition of the resurrected Christ is not a trick of the other disciples' mind. If someone comes to you and say they have seen and had tea with Jesus in their living room, what will be your reaction? I believe that Jesus is resurrected and with us, within us, around us. But how will I feel if David, Joanna, or Phil was telling me about their encounter with Jesus over tea? I will question their sanity and maybe even what they had in their tea. It doesn't make me a doubter of Jesus' resurrection. I am a Thomas, and I suspect that many of you will also be Thomas. So look again at the text very carefully. Thomas doesn't need to touch Jesus. He knew it was Jesus when he met him. He had no doubt. I am convinced that Jesus had ever doubted Jesus, that Thomas had ever doubted Jesus, or had a weak faith, or disloyal to Jesus. He was Thomas, a human being, listening to others telling him about something amazing. Meeting Jesus is a very personal encounter. I have no doubt that many will have met Jesus. Maybe not for tea, or maybe for tea, but when it happens, it is difficult to share with someone else who haven't experienced the same. Testimonies of encounter with Jesus very often make me uncomfortable when they are so well polished that you can expect what is going to be said. Meeting the resurrected Jesus defies the logic and common reason. It is very personal. It is almost a little bit messy. It is no surprise that others will struggle to believe it. And it is no surprise we struggle to find the right words. So Thomas thought the disciples were offering alternative facts to describe the one truth of the resurrected Christ. But when he saw, perceived, and encountered that one truth in front of him, he bowed down and accepted it, that he was wrong. Very different from individuals in our modern world who accept to believe in lies rather than to change their perception of the world, because it fits their understanding of the world to accept lies. They refuse to open their mind because the encounter with the truth is challenging our comfort zone of self-delusion. They rejected and they missed the opportunity to enrich or transform themselves and their understanding of the world. To accept that we may be wrong is a way to enrich ourselves and to accept that we are not the truth, but we accept the truth. But to accept these lies portrayed in alternative facts are very dangerous for our society. Look what's happened about deniers of vaccines or other amazing things as well. But it's also dangerous for the house of God itself. People believe in alternative facts, not believing in God's presence, despite feeling it, despite knowing it deep in themselves. It's a danger for our society and for the house of God, because it is divisive and it is based on lies and it is wrong. Truth is something we need to cherish. It's maybe very weak sometimes, it's very precious, and we need to love it and to accept it, and to accept the warmth of it. I'm sure you will have noticed that Jesus appears to the gathered disciples, not to individuals. When Jesus is on his own with a disciple, remember Mary Magdalene meeting Jesus in the graveyard. He is very cautious to tell her to not touch him. Jesus is not for individuals, but for the gathered disciples. He chooses to appear to the gathered disciples. These small details reaffirm us the importance to meet together, may it be in a church building, or through the computer, or phone, or transcript. The blessing of the resurrected Jesus is for the gathered church. God loves her children when they are united in faith and love. Do you remember the Psalm 133 we heard as a call of worship? God loves the united people. Belonging to the church is capital to feed our faith. He helps us to develop, grow our faith. But it is not an antidote, a vaccine against doubt. And in bad days, when we feel that God has abandoned us, we struggle with the truth. We are Thomas. We are human beings. Does that mean that there's no place for Jesus and individual encounter? No, there's always. Jesus is with us as well as individuals. But through the Spirit, this personal encounter are part of a bigger picture. We're always with our brothers and sisters through the world, through the Spirit. Meeting Jesus on a one-to-one basis is not a selfish experience. It's within the house of God, with the Spirit inviting us to be part of this amazing family. But this time we struggle with God. We struggle to perceive God, to see God. Or more exactly, the struggle and wish to know God even better. Or maybe sometime to fit God in a box and we want God to be the one we want him to be or her to be. That is maybe what we call the original sin, when we decide to not accept God the way he is, but to accept a God, an alternative God, who is not what he is. Jacob in Genesis shows us exactly that struggle between humans and God. We always struggle with God's presence in our life. We always struggle to understand God in our life. Jacob could touch God, but still wanted more. He wanted to know the name of God. The encounter of Jacob with God was not a peaceful one over tea. It was wrestling, it was struggling. It is also interesting to note that the sin happened during the night, time of uncertainty, times of eternal conflict and seductive alternative facts, tricking our own mind. Maybe it is part of our human condition to always seek for evidence and struggle to discern God's presence around us and within us. When we meet God, we struggle to convince others with words, even those who are seeking, like us, God. Sharing the good news is a constant struggle for our human condition. So like said St. Francis of Assisi, it may be better to show God to others through our deeds and being rather than through words. Because we can't. As soon as we put God in words, we're restraining God. We're offering alternative fact. In God, there's no alternative fact, but one truth. We may struggle with that truth, and we have some time to adapt and to accept we have been wrong. But we are reassured and comforted that this moment will pass, as Jesus is always with us. And Jesus will be with us at the last moment as well. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. In these conditions, this chapter of the Gospel of John cleverly ends telling us, now Jesus did many other things and signs in the presence of the disciple, which are not written in this book. No point to write them. If you have faith, you just accept them. You may defy the logic, but there's only one truth, no alternative fact. And that truth is to be found in the steadfast and generous love, hope and joy in the Liberator and loving Christ. Let us pray. God, our Divine Mother and Father, our eternal companion on the journey of life, we know how weak we are, how often we have fallen down because we are not paying attention to the road, the path, the walk. How often have we got lost because we took the wrong turn as we are distracted by alternative facts or forgot the end journey. Lord, open our heart, our soul, our mind to the sweet voice of your Spirit, guiding us with your grace through the challenges of life, so we can build your house here and now, later and there, always and everywhere, with our friends, our brothers and sisters, and always under Jesus' lead and for your glory. Amen.
As children of God and disciples of Christ, we welcome the Divine Spirit constantly transforming us so we may be in the one truth. So let us sing together hymn 391, O Breath of Life, come sweeping through us. Of God, it is right for us to pray for the world. When I say, Lord, hear our prayer, please could you respond, Lord, have mercy. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. So let us pray. Almighty Father and Mother, we pray for this earth we have damaged, and we pray that we may be able to restore it. We pray for those who suffer of war, disease, or an unfulfilled life because of our greed or prejudices. We pray specifically for the people of Syria, of Yemen, of China and North Korea. And this week we pray specifically for peace in Northern Ireland. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. We bring to you our hopes for the church of today and tomorrow, that we may remain your church, not ours. Not a social clique of people seeking self-righteousness, but that we may see us as humble servants of your creation and your house in this world. May we be your testimony of steadfast love and light of truth in our time. We pray specifically for our brothers, sisters, and friends present in this building and online or on the phone, but also those who couldn't join us today. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. We bring in our prayer, our loves, our blessing, and our worries for this community struggling in the post-COVID era with growing unemployment, homelessness, and despair. May we offer hope, love, and joy to these communities we belong to. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. We pray for those who mourn today. May they be well known, or may they be on their own. May they find comfort in your arms, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. We pray for ourselves, Lord, for our family and friends. We pray for those who are close to our heart. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy. Amen.
As a sign of the unity with all those who call themselves disciples of Christ around the world and in heaven, let us share the Lord's Prayer in a manner, version, and language which expresses our true self. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The truth, the only truth, is that steadfast love of God that we have received, and we have received also the command to share it with one another. So let us sing together hymn 712, Put Peace in Each Other's Hand.
Oh.
May the divine peace be with us. As the Father has sent Jesus, so he has sent us to the world to share the only truth of the Christ resurrected. Peace be with us, now and forever. Amen.